First of all, tell me your name.
I'm George Crowle.
Okay. And you're in Guelph?
No, I live in London, Ontario now.
Okay.
I taught at the University of Windsor in the Department of Religious Studies between 1968 and 1996.
Wow.
And I am somewhat embarrassed. I was teaching in social ethics in the Department of Religious Studies, and I'm somewhat embarrassed that I only learned about the money system in 1994.
I see.
But this is not surprising because hardly anybody knows about the money system.
Exactly.
I learned about it from an economist, John Hodson, who taught in the economics department at the University of Waterloo. And he was a great mentor for me and helped me learn about it.
Mm-hmm.
Back in the mid-90s, I was terribly concerned about the fact that our governments were cutting our social programs.
Mm-hmm.
But when you know about monetary policy, you can understand that this is totally unnecessary.
Yeah.
At present, we're having an austerity agenda pushed down our throats at the provincial and at the federal level.
That's right.
And it's being done internationally as well. Everybody knows about Greece, but all of Europe is facing the same kind of thing.
Exactly.
This is totally unnecessary. We're forced to think about this issue as a matter of fiscal policy, that is the management of income and spending.
But that's not it.
And that's right. This doesn't begin to deal with the real problem. We're familiar with fiscal policy because we all have our own
Money to spend and money to take in, yes?
Exactly.
Yes?
But at the family level, that's not even the same as it is at the government level.
No.
Because when a government lays off a bunch of people, cuts spending by laying off a lot of people, it loses the taxes that they pay.
Exactly.
So they don't save all that money that they had hoped to save.
It would be better if everybody was working, of course.
Yeah, right. And then they lose the taxes of people who lose their jobs because those people that they've laid off aren't spending in the economy.
And they have to pay them rather than...
yeah, that's right. That's right.
If it goes all the way to welfare.
Yeah, right.
So tell me a little bit about the Bank of Canada.
Let me explain the money system a little more
first. Good.
At present, Canada is governments across Canada at all levels are putting about $60 billion a year in interest payments.
Exactly.
All that expenditure is totally unnecessary.
Exactly.
Our governments are borrowing at interest from private banks and other private money lenders.
Exactly.
The private banks get to create that money out of nothing.
Exactly.
In fact, 97% of our money supply has been created by private banks in their process of making loans.
Exactly.
And they are able to take collateral from people.
Real things,
exactly. And they're able to make loans to them with money they create out of nothing, and they can collect interest and then collect the collateral if they fail to pay.
The trouble is that, for instance, if all of a sudden the government wanted to pay back all the money that they owe, there would actually, in every country, there would actually not be enough money to pay that back because the interest has never been put into circulation.
That's right.
The interest also comes out of thin air. So, you know, there's not enough money around.
Except well, the interest is not created by the banks. When the banks make those loans.
When they make loans.
They create the money for the principal, but they do nothing to create the interest they require to be paid.
Exactly.
And this is an enormous problem.
Yeah, totally.
People are driven to compete with each other. Borrowers compete in order to get money that's been created as principal to pay both principal and interest.
Exactly, exactly.
The interest is simply not available.
And for the simple man on the street, that is a concept that they wouldn't even know how to deal with, because, you know, we think, you know, it's normal to pay interest, and people don't think, what is it and where does it come from and where does it go?
Exactly.
You know,
exactly.
So 60, like you say, 60 billion or whatever you said, I mean, there's something there that is a phantom.
Right, right. Now that inflation is created by this system.
Exactly.
Because businesses have to push up prices in order to mm-hmm. get, among other things, the interest that they owe, mm-hmm. which has not been created. And then workers try to push up prices too, although they haven't been doing so well lately.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So inflation is caused not by too much money being out there, but by a scarcity of money.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
with this scarcity, inevitably, some people have default on their loans.
Exactly.
So this
and
system,
then they lose the little that they have, like the house.
Right, right.
Yes, whatever and, down payment they had or whatever, yeah. It is already paid, right?
And as more and more people default, then the economy goes into decline,
and
we get a recession.
And that's planned, as far as I can see.
And then the banks collect on their collateral, and as you say, more and more people are impoverished, while a few are greatly enriched.
Exactly.
So this system promotes disparities between the rich and the
poor. Yeah, divides people.
Right.
Now tell me a little bit about how we can work with this.
Yeah. Well, it's totally unnecessary for governments to be borrowing from the private sector, from private banks and other private money lenders, and to be paying interest.
Exactly.
The Bank of Canada was created during the 1930s, nationalized in 1938, provided interest-free money to all levels of government to meet public needs. The Bank of Canada served to get us out of the Great Depression, to carry through our responsibilities in World War II. And then it was used very creatively for 30 years after the war to build up our social programs and our mm-hmm. infrastructure.
Like with Tommy Douglas and the healthcare thing and so
exactly,
forth.
Exactly,
yeah,
right,
yeah,
right. Yeah. And Canada's highly enviable social programs came largely because of the creative role played by the Bank of Canada.
Mm-hmm.
But unfortunately, in about 1974, under pressure from the private banking system,
yes, I can imagine,
the government started at the federal level started shifting from borrowing from the Bank of Canada interest-free to borrowing from the private banks.
Right.
Now we could return to making use of the powers of the Bank of Canada
yes.
in this way, of course.
Have they done anything recently to weaken the powers of the Bank of Canada? Have they restricted them to? I mean, government, has anything happened that way?
Well, in the the kind of thing that's happened recently is that. The function of the Bank of Canada has been limited to raising or lowering interest rates, raising interest rates when there's a fear of inflation,
mm-hmm.
and then lowering it in the hope of being able to rescue the economy
mm-hmm.
when
mm-hmm.
There's a recession. And then,
but we could, in other words, it is as strong as it was in the 40s or so, that we could actually have the Bank of Canada look after our money rather than the private banks.
Well, there's that potential entirely.
Yeah. Yeah.
Now, there is a problem we'd have to be dealt with. Back in the early 90s, the government slipped in surreptitiously a law that removed from the private bank private banks the necessity for them to keep reserves. Mm-hmm. And this is, without going into the technical details, it's a means by which the power of the private banks could be limited to create money while the government is creating money. So it's entirely possible to have government-created money without inflation.
Mm-hmm.
Whenever you talk about the government participating in the creation of money, the immediate response from those who support the banking system is, well, oh, that would be inflationary. And then nobody has any answer for that, and that's the end of the discussion. Mm-hmm. And so we're stymied by that.
Yes.
The Bank of Canada still exists, and it's simply a matter of making use of its powers again.
Waking up the sleeping giant.
Right, right. Now, I suppose there's a danger with our present government that if they, this is really scary, that if they see a move toward using the Bank of Canada as it should be, that they might move to abolish it.
Yes, and that's why I say, because in the States they don't have that. They don't have any kind of system like we have in Canada. So Canada is actually positioned, I think, the best in order to change the money system.
Exactly, yes. Now, yeah, they don't have that system. They have a central bank, but it's privately owned.
Exactly. Federal Reserve is not federal. Right. It's not a reserve.
Right.
And it's just a private bank.
Right. And it's... Yeah. It's
connected with the World Bank and IMF, the International Monetary Fund.
So. It serves the interests of the private banking system, and we can see clearly how it functioned during the recent economic meltdown. Because they created money out of nothing in vast quantities to bail out the biggest banks of all, and the arrogant officers of those banks only gratefully and perhaps a little repentantly took that money and used it wisely. They gave themselves huge bonuses and took over other banks.
Well, of course, you know, as far as I can see, something like that can't really happen unless somebody plans it. So
absolutely. Know, so, it's there's every.
So in
evidence.
Other words, we have to really protect the Bank of Canada and make everybody
absolutely.
Know that there is such a thing and that we could turn Canada around as a first. I think Iceland did a little bit in that direction. They said to the international banks, "You're not going to get your money," and that's all there's
right.
to it.
That's right. And we need to move in that direction, and we need people to be conscious of how important this issue is.
Yes.
There's been discussion in recent years about joining our currency with that of the U.S. and Mexico
that would effectively get rid of the Bank of Canada.
Absolutely.
Which would be horrible.
Then we would no longer have any control over our own money system. That's a power that we have not made use of, but there's that enormous creative potential.
Yeah.
I mean, the Bank of Canada could... enable the government to provide interest-free loans. Infrastructure would be a great way to do it. If you have an interest-free loan to build a bridge or a public building,
anything like that,
you can pay for it once instead of paying for it
over and
two
over
or three.
Again.
Yes.
Yeah, like a house. I think you pay it three or four times over by the time that you actually pay it off.
Depending on the current interest rate. That's
exactly.
right.
Exactly. Yeah.
And.
Tell me a little bit about how does this affect you personally, knowing all these different things, and how do you reach out, and how do you, are people interested, or what's happening?
Well, personally, I feel that this is one of the most fundamental issues that we've got to deal with, and I've been working on it since 1994 when I first learned about it, because nobody else or hardly anybody else is doing it. Very few people are working on this
issue. Exactly,
And I am eager to do anything I can to raise people's awareness about this thing. I think I can explain it in a way that's not boring and that it's compelling.
Mm-hmm.
I remember Alexa McDonough telling me that people's eyes glaze over if you talk about the money system. Mm-hmm, but, you know, mm-hmm. when you talk about the fact that this austerity agenda that's being forced on us is not necessary.
No,
this
totally
is
not.
Very compelling
stuff. I mean, there's no shortage of work. There's lots of work.
Yeah.
I mean, here you can see here the parking lot could be mm-hmm. paved or whatever, or, you know, could be laid with stones or something.
Yeah.
And, you know, there's no shortage of work. People could grow food and pick weeds, whatever.
Right.
So if the money was there to do it, and of course, you know, how are loans given? Loans are only given when there's a collateral.
Right.
Which means that they give something that's totally worthless, and, you know, then the loan defaults and they get the collateral.
Well, they give something that's counted as it has power. It's money. And
it's got
power.
Yeah, but no real value.
But
can't eat it.
Well,
the native people say that you can't eat it.
Yeah, I know. I understand that. But I think we have to recognize that when we designate something as having money, that it has power to accomplish a lot.
Mm-hmm.
And we can take over that power to use it for public benefit rather than it's being used for the private benefit of banks and to enrich a few at the expense of the many.
And when you really think of it, if we got rid of money altogether, those people who are now rich wouldn't be rich.
Well, that's right. But it's, you know, in a complex society, we need money in order to carry out economic transactions.
Sure.
So we need publicly created money.
Yeah.
Now, there's another area where there's enormous promise, and that's... in the environmental area, in our current money system, you know, with companies trying to get sufficient money in order to pay off the interest, they seek to exploit environmental resources as one of the means by which they can do this.
Yes,
and so we have this assumption that endless economic growth is necessary.
And we have a finite planet.
Yeah, and we overlook the fact that we have a finite planet.
Exactly.
And but with publicly created money, we could be it's spending money, creating money for environmental preservation.
Exactly.
And reversing this process.
We wouldn't have to rape the earth the way we do now.
Right.
I mean, with fracking and tar sands and God only knows what else. Yeah.
Right, yes. And we need, we could be investing in development of all kinds of alternative energies that enable us to live in harmony with our environment rather than... exploiting it.
Now I just wanted to say I thank you very much. I know you have to go back into of course we have the chapter meetings for the Council of Canadians and the next part is probably already started, but I want to thank you very, very much for taking the time and talking to us here on YouTube, and all the power to everybody who will share this message with everybody.
Well, thank you, and I'd be glad to speak to
any group
about this.
So just connect with the Council of Canadians, the London chapter, London, Ontario.
That would be a way of doing it.
There we go.
Yeah.
Well, thank you very, very much. I appreciate it.
Thank you.